Hi, good morning students. Now we are going to see some topics in the fourth unit. Already we have discussed some of the topics in input-output organization. Now we are going to be discussing about the topic called DMA, Direct Memory Access. Before going to this particular topic, we want to see about the data transfer. In the previous discussions, we seen that there are two modes of data transfer. One is called as a programmed I/O and the second one is called as a interrupt driven I/O. In the programmed I/O, the processor keeps on scanning whether any device is ready for data transfer. If any device is ready, the processor fully dedicates itself in transfer of data between I/O device and memory, and it transfers the data at high rate, but it cannot involve in any other activity during the data transfer. This means the processor only dedicates for the data transfer only. It does not perform any other activity during the data transfer. In interrupt driven I/O, whenever the device is ready for data transfer, then it raises an interrupt to the processor. Here the processor does not keep scanning for peripherals ready for data transfer, but it finally involves in the data transfer. This is the second method. In the two methods, if you want to transfer the data between I/O devices and memory, we need the processor involvement. So coming to our present topic, direct memory access. This is a mode of data transfer between memory and I/O device. This happens without involvement of the processor. So that means whenever you want to transfer the data, in the DMA directly we will transfer the data in between of I/O devices and memory. There is no need to involve the processor. This is called as a DMA control unit. The DMA control unit which performs the transfers is a part of I/O device interface circuit. The DMA controller performs functions that would normally carried out by the processor. For each word, it provides the memory address and all the control signals. To transfer a block of data, it increments the memory address and keep track of number of transfers. Here, the block of data means in block of data, number of words will be there. So whenever you want to transfer the data means the DMA wants to increment the locations of the words and keep how many transfers have been required to transfer the data. The DMA controller can transfer a block of data from an external device to the processor without any intervention from the processor. To initiate the DMA transfer, the processor informs the DMA controller of three ways. One is a starting address, that means the block of data where we want to start the transfer. The number of words in the block, that means how many words are there in that particular block, for example 8 words, 16 words, 32 words, like that. And the third one is direction of transfer. Here direction of transfer means in two ways the transfer of data will be done. We can transfer the data from input-output device to memory or from memory to input-output devices. Once the DMA has completed the data transfer, it informs the processor by generating one interrupt signal. Once an interrupt signal has been generated, the processor will assume that the data transfer has been completed. So this is the DMA controller that we will use in a computer system. Here a bus is there. For the bus, two disk DMA controllers has been connected. So here the main memory, this is the processor. In between of this bus cable, and we are using one interface that is called as a bridge. For this disk or DMA controller, we are using two disks, and for this DMA controller, we are using one network interface card. The DMA controller connects a high speed network to the computer bus. The disk controller, which controls two disks, also has a DMA capability. It provides two DMA channels. So that means two disks are there separately. We are using two DMA channels for performing the work. It can perform two independent DMA operations as if each disk has its own DMA controller. So here two DMA controllers we have been used. So every DMA controller can perform its own work. So independently the two DMA controllers are going to be work. To store all these information, we require three registers. So the three registers is going to be stored. The first register will store the memory address. The second register will store the word count, that means number of words. And the third register is going to be stored status and control information. The processor and DMA controller have to use the bus in an interwoven fashion to access the memory. So that means whenever you are transferring the data, here the processor and the DMA controller will access the bus. DMA devices generally has given higher priority whenever we compare with the processor. Whenever it is accessing the bus cable, the DMA devices will given the first priority when we compare with the processor. Among different DMA devices wants to connect for this bus, higher priority will given for high speed peripherals such as a disk or graphic display devices. So that means a device or any input output device, that means a peripheral which have a high speed, that have been given the highest priority. The processor originates more memory access cycles on the bus. So in two ways it is going to be performed. One is called as a cycle stealing, and the second one is called as a block or burst mode. The first one, a cycle stealing. DMA controller can be set to steal memory access cycles from the bus. This is interleaving technique is called as a cycle stealing. It is stealing some memory access cycles from the bus. So that's why this technique is called as a cycle stealing. An alternate approach is provide a DMA controller an exclusive capability to initiate transfer on the bus and hence exclusive access to the main memory. This is called as a block or burst mode. In these two ways, the processor originates the memory access cycles on the bus. So whenever you go for this particular DMA controller, so we have some advantages and some disadvantages. The first advantage is transferring the data without involvement of the processor will speed up the read-write task. Here, whenever you are performing this transferring of data, so the processor involvement will not be there. Direct transfer will be done in between of these memory and I/O device or I/O device and memory. So whenever it is happening, automatically it will speed up the process. The process can be either a read process or a write process. The second advantage is DMA reduces the number of clock cycles to transfer data. Here, see this particular advantage. So in the previous mode, data transfer. So the data transfer will be done from I/O device to processor, processor to memory. That means I/O device to processor one cycle, from processor to memory another clock cycle. That means totally two clock cycles required to transfer the data from I/O device to memory. But whenever you go for this DMA controller, we are directly transferring the data in between of I/O device and memory. That means only one clock cycle is required. So that's why in the DMA we can reduce one clock cycle whenever we compare with the previous modes. The third advantage is the workload of the processor reduced. Here, whenever you are using this DMA, so for data transfer we does not use the processor. The processor can be used for other activities and we can reduce the data transfer work from the processor. These are the three main advantages whenever we are using a DMA controller. The disadvantage of this one is cache coherence problem occur when DMA is used for data transfer. Generally, to speed up the data transfer, we are using a cache memory. So whenever you apply this one, so there is a chance to get a cache coherence problem in data transfer. And the second disadvantage is whenever you use this DMA, automatically it will increase the price of the system. Thank you.